This is an Empowered Living audio, brought to you and narrated by Empowered Living.
My story. At the time of this writing, I have a 20-month-old German Shepherd, Peter. Peter is a very adorable pet that has become an integral part of my family. Every member in the house absolutely loves him. Since he's come into our lives, we have actually gotten a valuable family member who loves without judgment, has no inhibitions, and expects nothing in return. Yes, all he wants is love. And just love. We actually inherited him from an ex-neighbor whose dog had given birth 2 years ago. We brought him home as an adorable 2-month-old puppy who was ever so energetic and entertaining at his best. However, when he was 8 months old, I landed a job at an ad agency, and I was often working more than 9 hours a day. With my wife and kids both out of the house for work and school, respectively, Peter was usually at home alone. We were sometimes able to get a neighbor to check in on him from time to time. Gradually, he started resenting being left alone at home and would whine incessantly the minute he saw me getting ready for work. He even resisted my neighbor when she used to give him his regular meals, as he would often leave it untouched. Since we generally let him roam the house, he began to destroy everything in sight. Even after dog-proofing the house, he still managed to find something to get into. We built a kennel for him that was wired to keep him inside when we were out, but with time he even bent the wires and whined all the time when he was in it. Matters became worse when he broke one of his teeth and broke the metal welding on the kennel to the point that he could escape with it being closed. Since he literally destroyed the kennel, we threw it out and let him roam the house again. Once again, he began to destroy the house. After doing some research, I realized that he was suffering from a condition called separation anxiety. We put him on medication for the separation anxiety, and it appeared to have helped for a while. I tried to get a dog trainer, but he told me to retry the crating, which did not help much. I later realized that crating should have been performed long before his ailment. I gradually took him for 30 to 45 minute daily walks before I left him, filled up 2 Kongs with peanut butter, and gave him a bone that would keep him full and entertained. Gradually, I tried crate training again, and gave him his food in the crate, and he started voluntarily going into the crate with his bowl of food with a satisfied but half-hearted smile. We left the crate open for him, and whenever he wanted to go in the crate, when we left the house, he could, but he could also roam about if he chose to do so. I did not want to crate him for the rest of his life while we were at work, though, and I also didn't want him to stay on medication forever, either. I started reading more about separation anxiety and discovered many methods to help Peter. Much to my amazement, there were a lot of other people with dogs suffering from the same disorder, but there was very little information available on the subject. Dog owners have the misconception that they have a bad dog, when in actuality their pet may be suffering from separation anxiety, which can be cured. I decided to help my fellow dog lovers by finding out everything I could on the subject and making it available in one place. This book represents the culmination of my efforts to achieve this goal. I hope this manual will be of help to you and your pet, and that it will provide the best information available on dog separation anxiety. May this book help you to regain the composure and calm your household is craving. My best to you. Chapter 1. Our Pet's Emotions. Most of us who nurture family pets know exactly how they behave when they try to express their emotions. They may not always howl or growl to get things done, but body language and gestures are more than enough to give an idea of their needs. However, we need to tune in our minds to differentiate between positive and negative emotional expressions. For that, let us list some common emotions seen in pets and their expressions therein. Happy. Key features of a happy dog are ears perked up and forward, eyes wide open, mouth relaxed and slightly opened, and teeth covered. Body and tail relaxed. A happy dog does not attempt to look one in the eye, and will probably go through the typical sniffing pattern. It is advisable to offer the dog the back of one's wrist to smell before attempting to pet it. Submissive. This includes both active and passive submissive postures. Passive submission. This is when the dog lays down on its back, belly up. It is a pacifying gesture that is offered to a more dominant individual, the owner or a close family member. The dog appears to want to have its belly rubbed in this position. Key features of this behavior are ears back, exposed belly, tail tucked in, and head turned away with an indirect gaze. Active submission. A pacifying pose when the dog acknowledges another dog or human's higher ranking, or to inhibit another dog's aggression. The key features are ears back, tail hung low, wagging slowly, one paw raised, eyes half closed, mouth nearly closed with just the tip of the tongue darting out. Aggression. Aggression in dogs includes defensive-aggressive behavior in addition to becoming aggressive. In a defensive-aggressive posture, a dog is fearful and is giving warning signals to indicate that it does not want to be approached, but if it is, it will attack to protect itself. The key features of this pose are ears back, pupils dilated, mouth is tense, wrinkled, and snarling with exposed teeth, the tail is down and tense, posture is mildly crouched with weight over the rear legs. Aggressive behavior is indicated by open, snarling mouth with exposed teeth, ears up with tail up and tense, eyes making direct contact, and growling. Playful. Playfulness is the body language a dog expresses when trying to initiate play. It bows down in front, which is a combination of submissive and dominant gestures. This stance is offered to invite another dog or human to play or as a part of courtship behavior. Identifying features are front end of the dog lowered as if ready to leap forward, mouth open and relaxed with tongue exposed. Why are we concentrating so much on these gestures? What has it got to do with separation anxiety in dogs? For starters, getting used to common gestures and body language is essential to gauge what a pet wants to express, especially for a person who has a newly acquired pet. It is very important to understand day-to-day expressions of emotions in our pets. This will help you to differentiate abnormal activity or behavior from normal expressions. In the next chapter, we'll formally introduce separation anxiety in dogs and get a basic understanding of its implications. Chapter 2. What is dog separation anxiety? Separation anxiety is a critical behavioral problem, which can cause tremendous emotional distress for both dogs and their owners. It can occur in dogs of any age or breed, and is one of the most common reasons for pet owners to euthanize or give up their dogs. Most dogs with normal behavior characteristically sleep, bark randomly, or chew their toys when left alone in the house or in a room without access to its owner. In general, they pretty much do what they normally do when you're with them. For dogs with separation anxiety, they can make leaving the house or even the room an emotional hitch and a difficult task for its owner. Separation anxiety can cause dogs to whine or bark incessantly, pace, chew furniture, destroy blinds, rip up carpeting, eat through drywall, climb bookcases, mutilate plants, or scratch at windows and doors. Dogs with severe separation anxiety can destroy thousands of dollars in internal furnishings, go through plate glass windows injuring themselves, bloody their mouths and paws, and defecate and urinate, eliminate everywhere. Their howling, barking, and whining can also lead to problems with neighbors and landlords. What are the main causes of separation anxiety? It is not fully understood exactly why some dogs suffer from separation anxiety, and under similar circumstances, others don't. Separation anxiety can be seen in animals from multiple or single pet homes. It may be more likely to occur in animals with a history of abuse or of multiple homes. Dogs that have missed out on normal social interaction with people or other animals, especially as puppies, may also be at increased risk. Separation anxiety typically occurs in the following cases. A dog has never or rarely been left alone, or the ones that were not properly integrated into their first home and got relegated to a basement, garage, or yard. Dogs who were removed from their mother and litter mates too early, prior to 8 weeks of age, or too late, after 14 weeks. Following a long interval, such as a vacation, where the owner and the dog were constantly together. After a traumatic event, from the dog's point of view, such as a period of time spent at a shelter or boarding kennel, or an event that occurred which was a significantly frightening experience for your dog. A dog that has never had a prior problem may develop separation anxiety when there is a change in the owner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.